I'm a Brazilian, Teresa Andrade, professor of Portuguese and scientific methodology, and visiting professor at the University of Malta. I'm here to talk with Mrs. Vera Duarte, an author from Cape Verdean, who is poet and novelist. Vera Duarte was elected the patroness of the Lusophone Colloquiums in 2016 in Açores, and Lusophone corresponding member of the Academy of Sciences of Lisbon in May 2017 in Portugal. Currently, she is also president of the Cape Verdean Academy of Letters. I'd prepared these 7 questions about her novel, The Matriarch, A Story of Miscegenation. Miss Duarte, I can start.
Okay, of course.
Okay, first, your polyphonic novel, The Matriarch, A Story of Miscegenation, emphasizes matriarch as a subject and as a theme, miscegenation. Could you tell us about what has inspired you to create this interrelation?
Good evening. The fact that we have a mixed race African society has always challenged me, and I have always sought to understand those historians and anthropologists how Cape Verdean Creole society was formed. In Antonio Carreira, a historian, with its fundamental work, Training and Extinction of a Slave Society, and Antonio Correia Silva notes, and several others, I have been finding answers, but my own family of Jewish origin on the maternal side and of African origin on the paternal side also served as a stimulus in the search of Cape Verdean geology. On the other hand, I have always been sensitive to the situation of women in Cape Verde and in the world, the status of inferiority to which she was voted has always outraged me, knowing above all that she is a source of life and everything she does for family and the community. We live in a matriarchal de facto society, but of patriarchal contents, even though patriarchy is in decline. I must say that I prefer to read because, as I'm not an English speaker, I have difficulty of speaking just like this, so I prefer to read my answers.
Okay. Second, the narrative is developed in the socio-historical context of diaspora and ancestry. What can you tell us about the Cape Verdean ancestry conveyed in this narrative?
The matriarch seeks to make clear the threads of which the web of Cape Verdean ancestry is woven. On the one hand, the Europeans, starting with the Portuguese and the men of discovery, Genovese, Spaniards, and others, and as well as sailors, corsairs, adventurers, and condemned people. On the other hand, African people, especially Olofs, Lebus, and Sereres, most of them in the sad and humiliating condition of enslaved, but also some free men and women, such as the episode reported by Antonio Carreira, of Prince Bemoi, whose population revolted and came to Cape Verde, bringing the woman and gentleman who constitute his courts.
Third question. You open the subdivisions of the novel with the epigraph Esther, Old Testament, as well as having chosen the name Esther for the protagonist. What is the connection between the Old Testament and the plot?
Through the figure of Esther, who is the protagonist, a woman who in the antiquity for her gentility, beauty, and intelligence leads the liberation of her Jewish people. Also in the Middle Age, Esther reveals herself to be a woman of great strength and an unstable personality. According to the episode I had imagined between her and the Inquisitor Mor of sad memory, Tomás de Torquemada, I create this contemporary heroine, a beautiful, intelligent, and caring woman who would be the example for many women. Esther symbolizes the fundamental values that I attribute to knowledge as a factor of development of peoples, which so well characterizes Jewish people. This ascendance represents the great contribution that Jews give to the formation of Cape Verdean society as a society turned towards the education and the knowledge. Fiction the ancestrality of my protagonist in a woman so strong is for me a sign of hope in the present and in the future, and a rescue of a feminine past, striking, but that was always been long forgotten.
Fourth, Bakhtin and the problems of Dostoevsky's poetics, among other aspects, highlights the concepts of polyphony, dialogism, and carnivalization. Can one say that there is a similarity between the narrative structure of the matriarch and the structure of Dostoevsky's novel, The Idiot, for example? We can see some features: the division into parts, the polyphonic characters, the dialogism, the intertextuality, the carnivalization, and the author narrator as if he were another character.
Well, note that I'm not a literary scholar, and with due regard for the fact that Dostoevsky is a literary icon of humanity from the immense Russia, and I am an illustrious unknown from the small island of Cape Verde, I think there are some remarkable coincidences between the matriarch and the idiot. First of all, polyphony. I do not write looking for a style. I write how words flow me. That is how, in poetry, I was the first Cape Verdean author to write prose poetry. Only after a few years, and with the comments that were being made to my writing, I did understand that I had innovated in poetry. Also with the novel The Matriarch, the readers and scholars have been pointing out the polyphony as one of the main characteristics. There is an actor who narrates, some personage narrators, finally a true polyphony of voices. There is a lot of intertextuality and intratextuality in a deliberate way. Hence, in the wake of what Bakhtin calls the polyphony of narrative in Dostoevsky's Idiot, also can be called polyphony in The Matriarch. Secondly, because just as Dostoevsky wanted the idiot to give an idea of Russia of the época through the eyes of the personage, so too did I, confess, early, want the matriarch to provide insight into what new century and millennium is in Cape Verde. I also draw my attention to the fact that the central characters of the idiot, Prince Lev Mishkin, is a good person without hatred or hate, because I too, with my central personage, Esther, I wanted an exemplary woman whose heart has no hatred or grudge. It should be noted that the protagonism does not end with the figure of Esther. Other personages sometimes assume the status of main character. And finally, it is true that my characters also have a life of their own. Sometimes they escape from my script, and I often use term to say that I mean to society itself or to send message.
Okay. Fifth, in part one, in the topic, a seminar on the origins of the Cape Verdean people, page 32 to 39, the protagonist Esther prompts the readers towards some research questions. Among them, what is the African heritage? What is the European heritage? What is the Jewish heritage? Will there be other heritages? Have you ever considered the possibility of creating the second volume of the matriarch from the results collected through interviews and life history?
Oh, no, because I'm not a scholar. I'm just a dilettante. What I really want to do is to help to stimulate in young people the taste for our history, anthropology, and literature. But as you say that, perhaps someday, if I had the inspiration, I will continue the story of the matriarch.
Okay. Vicky's, in the interrelations among the characters, several cultural practices are discussed, which include the presence of patriarchal values, food, religion, stereotypes, prejudices, and bullying. What is your position with regards to the different roles of the woman matriarch and the political educational work in human rights implementation?
Bom, I usually say that human rights are my second skin. In other words, I can see practically nothing without being from the point of view of the human rights, except, of course, love and poetry, and even those. The issue of emancipation and empowerment of women has always challenged me, and I have always developed an intense activism in this area, whether through human rights, through literature, or through my profession, the judicial magistrature. I thus took advantage of the matriarch characters to materialize this topic.
The last question. Would you like to talk about another topic that you have not been asked about?
If you give me the opportunity. In the wake of the Brazilian professor Simone Caputo Gomes, a scholar of Cape Verdean literature on world literature, I would like to point out the following. The migratory and transnational vocation of the Cape Verdeans has appeared since the 16th century in a text by the immortal of the Cape Verdean Academy of Letters, André Alves de Almada, which contains the earliest testimony to the migratory vocation of the Cape Verdean people. Even those who never left the islands, like the case of the immortal, the poet George Barbosa, whose poetics is preached by the image of the bird closed, exactly for never having left the islands, the dream was to live and travel the world. Even doctors who never left because they did not want to live, like myself, the world literature concept that has been gaining more and more stage in the contemporary world is our vocation. World literature that in the proposal of Alain Mabankou is the one that bases complicities behind the continents, the nationalities, the religions, and the geological trees. It is a post-colonial writing that gives prominence to writers' sayings on the margins and the peripheries, such the authors, the African authors, Asians, Latinos, humans, blacks, and all minorities who live in our world. My writing fits into this vast field of world literature. To paraphrase the poet Philine Tillise, I feel like a Cape Verdean woman who, through the humanist penchant, stands as a citizen of the world. I am island and I am cosmos. For this reason, I am in debt to the organization of this beautiful festival, which is Malta Book Festival, the privilege granted me by associating myself with this extraordinary moment of world literature. I thank you all.
And thanks for your questions.
Thank you.
Do you have any questions? Okay, thank you.
So, thank you.